Welcome to Ravenswood, Sir Anthony. It is such an honour to have you here and have the opportunity to have a discussion with you.
Oh, it's so nice to be at the school. And thank you for showing me around, which was a really impressive experience.
Wonderful. Well, it's such a pleasure. Well, these are momentous times in Britain, especially with the recent resignation of Prime Minister Boris Johnson. Now, amongst your many esteemed roles, you are the historical advisor to No. 10 Downing Street and have also written a series of books reflecting on the history of leadership in Britain, but particularly a very compelling book that I had the opportunity to read that relates to the office of the British Prime Minister. Having reflected on the tenures of these Prime Ministers and thinking about Boris Johnson's recent resignation, what advice would you offer around leadership to an incoming Prime Minister?
Well, it's a very difficult job leading a country, and I think it's become increasingly difficult. Mm. I would have to say that I think that women leaders are doing better globally than the male leaders. I think there's a number of reasons for that. Mm. And they're shown up in a way by Boris Johnson, who was Britain's 55th Prime Minister since the office was created 300 years ago. Boris Johnson had no grasp of detail. Mm. And you need to have detail. Mm. And women leaders tend to be more conscientious. Right. He was superbly unconscientious. But also, he was very unprincipled. Mm. And women leaders globally tend to be more principled and live out a set of values more. And he really fell because his conduct was so immoral. Mm. He wasn't providing that ethical leadership that leaders need to provide. And because he was not on top of the job and because he was not giving a strategy.
We're really proud because one of our Ravenswood alumni, Catherine West, is a member of the House of Commons, and she's been quite active looking to hold Boris Johnson to account for his behaviour. And we're proud that, again, that aspect of leadership is coming through, that it's also about being able to stand for what you believe in and hold true to those values. And
so I think the advice is very clear to future leaders. It is that really all your girls here at Ravenswood can be leaders in some way or other.
Yes.
It's quite possible that there will be a future Prime Minister of their country amongst your current girls. And it would be quite possible that it would not be those who necessarily are maybe flying at the top, the obvious girls, of course, it might be, but it might not be.
Yes.
And that's interesting because some people develop leadership later. But what's really important is that you have a very clear vision of what you're trying to do. I mean, it's important for a school leader, a university leader, a corporate leader. And unless you know what you're trying to do, and Boris Johnson, again, didn't know what he wanted to do, you don't go anywhere. And it's to know what you want to do and then to be able to appoint the right people to do it. So I think those are the key messages, and of course having resilience, because it's incredibly demanding to be a national leader and be any kind of leader, and you need to be able to keep going through the difficult periods which inevitably are going to come up.
Definitely. In fact, our school prefects this year, Sir Anthony, have come up with a slogan which is "Together, no matter the weather," which I think is so appropriate for these times.
It is. It is. I think that's a great. That's a great motto.
And I think it's also a reminder, as you say, to bring the team around you and also to help activate their talents and to focus on helping them fulfil their potential, so that you can all lift together and achieve together.
That's right, To believe in teams, you have to be able to trust people. And some find it very hard to trust other people. And to give up some of your power to others in the recognition that collectively you're all better off if you stand together.
Fantastic. So I have the absolute honour of serving on your IPEN board, and obviously you're the co-founder of the International Positive Education Network with Professor Martin Seligman, and it is a great privilege to work with you on that. And you also have been a transformational leader as a headmaster of two leading schools, as well as vice chancellor of a university over in England. Having had the opportunity to lead in that capacity and be so involved with education, what has inspired you to pursue positive education and really do some pioneering work in that area?
So it's interesting, isn't it? Mm. Because throughout much of Ravenswood history, no one would have heard of the word positive education or indeed well-being. Even 15 years ago, people hadn't really heard of it very much. And now it's everywhere. And schools used to be about much more about exam results and performance, whereas now we look more at the quality, not just the quantities of what the girls can achieve, and students, boys included, can achieve. And we're looking at how they do it. And we recognize that that mental well-being matters. Yes. If we worry about it, of course, it can actually decline our mental being, but we need to worry about it in the right ways and to do the right courses of action. So when I was head of a school in the UK called Wellington College, which was the National Memorial, is the National Memorial to Wellington, who defeated Napoleon famously at the Battle of Waterloo, and we were set up by Queen Victoria. When I took that over, it occurred to me that really the well-being of students was not being attended to very well, and I came across Professor Seligman, and we worked out how we could introduce a program at Wellington that would enhance the well-being of our young people to enhance their performance at academically at exams, but also to enhance their performance in the arts and leadership and at sport. And there are things that we can do that really do make a difference. Mm-hmm. We can learn about when we're young that we can then carry forward with us the rest of our life. And so Wellington at that time was probably the leading, the most conspicuous school in the country, pushing forward happiness, as it was called. And so setting up the body that you mentioned, which brings together different nations around the world in terms of what they are doing for young people in colleges and schools and universities, into the body called IPEN, was founded at my school, Wellington, 11 years ago. And it's a really important body because we, children everywhere, young people are pretty much the same, parents pretty much the same, teachers pretty much the same, whether you're talking about the Philippines or Scotland or Peru, or Australia, and we can learn so much more from each other.
That's true.
So that's what I did.
Marvellous. Let's think about these girls, particularly our amazing class of 2022 students who have navigated their way through COVID, still happening, and are preparing for their trial examinations. And in fact, they'll conclude their schooling at the end of this term. What advice would you give to these girls as they prepare for life beyond our school gates?
Well, I think to your class of 22, obviously, congratulations on your perseverance coming through. The most difficult and disrupted school experience that young people, whether in Australia or in the United Kingdom, where I'm from, or in America, or in Japan, wherever you come from, it has been the most disruptive. So well done coming through that. And good luck for your final term, girls, when you leave in September, is it? And then you'll be going up to university next February 23. And I think it's important to make the most of, obviously, your final term. Keep yourself as calm as you can be for exams and just do your best. Don't try and be brilliant. Just try and do your best. And if this or that paper or question doesn't go well, don't make a big deal about it. Just move on to the next. Yeah, you know, that's very important. But then when you're thinking about the future, university is very different to schools. I ran a university and it was even more obvious to me then that young people come up without all the skills that you need to conduct yourself. So learn the lessons that you've had at Ravenswood better than in most schools in the country about well-being and positive education, because these will really serve you well when you get to university and you're on your own and no one is going to be making certain you get up on time or check whether you're eating nourishing food and whether you're getting enough exercise. Internalize these messages and really reflect on them, because where things go wrong for students at university, it is because they've ignored the basics. You know, if you have a car and you don't put enough, top it up with electricity or diesel or petrol and dump enough oil and water in it or air in the tires, it doesn't work, you know, and we're just like that. So look after yourselves and really think about some of the most valuable things that you will have learned here will have been what you've learned on POSED and wellbeing.
Fantastic. Thank you. That's such practical wisdom. And when you talk about the strategies that are so effective, what would you point to? You know, can you reflect on your own practice of building wellbeing and what's been most effective for you?
Well, I think it's one can answer that question in many ways, but clearly befriending our bodies is important. And we are given our bodies, but we're not given very much information about how our bodies work. Well, I mean, our bodies are absolutely amazing creations. And if we can learn to go with the grain of our body and help our body, then our body will look after our minds. What I should have been doing was drinking in my life much more of water, because so many headaches are caused by insufficient water. Taking regular exercise. So today I've just noted that I've done 2,462 steps. Now I have a target of 10,000 every day. That means I've got over 7,000 to go. But you know, having targets that physically, and getting that heart rate up, in particular, three times a week, getting your heart rate up for 20 minutes, and you can do that by jogging or playing tennis or playing netball, or simply walking quickly. The heart rate comes right up and the breathing comes up. And that does us a lot of good, and learning to eat things which the body likes and which are good for the body, and then learning how to rest and relax so that we're not constantly on our gadgets at night or in bed, because they stimulate. It's not just the light. And there's a debate whether, in fact, it's the light or whether it is the association of these gadgets that we have. So it's learning about how to rest before sleep. And it's and mindfulness is something that is helpful if it's done well. And then learning habits of kindness and compassion. If one wants to upset oneself, upset other people. I mean, it's a really, really good way of being unhappy and just go around and be nasty to other people, and it will make us feel unhappy. And conversely, if we go out of our way to do little things for other people, if we say nice things, if we avoid saying undermining things, then it makes us feel better. I mean, it really needs to come from here rather than just here. But the more we can develop those habits, And the more we can learn to be appreciative, not mm-hmm. constantly, I mean, here is your glass here is more or less half full, but some would see the same glass and say, well, it's half empty.
Mm-hmm.
And the more we can see what is there rather than what isn't there, the happier we become. And this is interesting. The more we concentrate on this, the more this grows.
Yes.
And the more we concentrate on what there is there and the positive, the more positive we become.
Wonderful.
Those are just some ways.
That's excellent.
There are many ways. I mean, there are many things. If we had more time, we could talk about.
Of course. No, that's tremendously helpful. And I know that you were at the forefront of the Times Commission into Education, which was a very expansive study. What were the findings there, Sir Anthony?
So education is changing rapidly. And it's interesting to see how far ahead in thinking Ravenswood is, because we don't serve our students or our staff well if we are lost in a rut. But the truth is that schools and indeed universities the world over are stuck in a 19th or 20th century rut of a kind of factory model of passive learning without really understanding what it is we're learning. It's about information, the acquisition and the repetition of information without looking at really knowledge, but deeper than knowledge is understanding, and then deeper than understanding is wisdom. And so the world over, we've reduced education to metrics, which are looking at a very narrow part of what it means to be human. And it's very degrading for young people the world over to have just this limited aspect. But so many things have changed. COVID will change education, has changed education forever. So has the whole concern about the future of the planet.
Yes.
So has globalization. So has new understandings of the ways that we learn. We know that if students learn passively, if the teacher barks out instructions and the girls just write it down without really engaging with the material, it will be a superficial knowledge rather than active learning, where they're thinking for themselves. We also know that AI is beginning to fundamentally change the way that education takes place. And indeed, of course, the world that we're preparing our girls and indeed boys for. I mean, in all these ways and more, we need to really flatten once and for all the factory model of education and replace it by something much more intuitive and imaginative. So that's why I took the idea to the Times newspaper, owned ultimately by Rupert Murdoch, of course, and we've had a commission that's lasted a year with just interviewing over 600 very brilliant people, from financiers to leading artists and scientists and thinkers and educationalists to try to understand more how we can remodel education.
Brilliant. Any key findings emerging at this point?
Well, I'm seeing walking around a lot of that in the school that I've seen here, including your delightful little pockets of space. Girls need spaces where they can form their own groups and can talk in clusters and relate to each other. They need multi-dimensional spaces to grow. Sometimes one-on-one, sometimes solitary, sometimes in threes and fours, sometimes in larger groups and year groups. So, I'm seeing a lot of it here. And that wonderful herb garden it is really bringing nature into schools, but also imagination. If you have dull, plodding architecture, the students are much more likely to be dull and plodding. If you have imaginative, inspiring architecture, you're much more likely to inspire and elevate young people. So there's some really extraordinary buildings here I've seen.
Fantastic.
No one on earth is removed, isolated from the habits of well-being, things that we talk about in POSED. They are, of course, very well underpinned by research in America, in this country, across Europe, and elsewhere. But they're also grounded on wisdom, which goes back thousands of years. They're also there in the Bible. But I think there also needs to be more buy-in from people who think that it, you know, it doesn't apply to them, or doesn't apply to their children, or doesn't apply to the school, or this is a distraction from getting the best results at the International Baccalaureate or whatever exam might be coming up. Actually, do this well, and the results at IB and the other exams will be better. I mean, it is amply proved that young people, all of us, perform better when we are physically and mentally and emotionally and indeed spiritually in a better place. It cannot but be true. And so Ravenswood is leading Australia in a direction that other schools it will be bound to follow, because you run with the grain of history.
Fantastic. Thank you, Sir Anthony Seldon, so much. It's been a wonderful discussion. And thank you for your pioneering work in this area and all you are doing, not only through Action for Happiness, but so many different organisations to really propel us forward and to be the best versions of ourselves, but also to make a difference to others beyond ourselves. And obviously, I look forward to continuing to work with you with IPEN and for all that's ahead for our country and obviously our world in terms of helping to support particularly the well-being of young people.
Well, and thank you, Anne, for the school and the state and the national and indeed the global leadership that you are giving this whole activity.
Thank you, Sir Anthony.